the video called Making Sure Your Objectives Are Useful, we talked about how to refine your objectives and make sure that they're precise and measurable, as well as communicating something worthwhile to you and your students. I talked to a group of expert teaching assistants to help coach them through this process of refining their objectives. Joining me is Sarah Sider, a teaching fellow in the Ecology and Evolutionary Biology department. We've both helped faculty refine learning goals, and so you can see here the process by which we help these teaching assistants refine their goals.
So now that you've had a chance to write some learning goals, Sarah is joining me again to help us talk about your goals. So does someone want to share what they've written?
My first draft of the goal was, and this is for the plate tectonics, was just explain or understand the geologic phenomenon that occurred at each plate boundary.
Okay. So understand the geologic phenomenon. So what would you mean by understand?
I would want the students to be able to describe what's going on at each plate boundary and then also explain how and why these things are happening there.
Mm-hmm. So could you give an example of what a really good answer to that would be for any plate boundary that is your favorite?
My favorite plate boundary. That'd be something along the lines of, like, you know, at a continental oceanic convergent plate boundary, you have a deep ocean trench, and you have subduction of the oceanic crust, and then that ocean crust has a lot of water with it, with the sediment, and that makes it melt, and then that excess of melt rises up through the continental crust, and then you get big explosive volcanoes.
So do you have a better goal in mind then?
Yeah, my revised version of that goal was describe the geologic phenomenon that occur at each plate boundary, such as landforms, deformation, rock types, etc., and then explain how and why each of these things occur where they do.
And that's, sometimes we try to pack a lot into one goal. I might actually piece that apart into two goals.
So I am thinking about the four questions from animal behavior, these four questions that we can use to explore animal behavior. And one learning goal is apply the four questions to a behavior. And instead of being kind of vague, I mean, apply is like an okay word, but I wanted to get a little bit more specific. So I refined that into formulate hypotheses from the standpoint of each of the four questions. So just like being a little bit more specific and making sure students know how to actually apply those four questions.
Yeah, I like the formulating hypothesis. That's like a really specific way of utilizing that that content. So yeah, I think that's really cool.
Trevor, remind us of your topic.
So we were talking about crystal structures, and in particular metallic crystal structures. And one of the things that I'd like my students to be able to do is to calculate the atomic packing factor in a crystal structure.
What is that?
So the atomic packing factor basically says how much free space is there versus how much is actually occupied by an atom. Or, you know, atoms are made up of mostly nothing anyway, but we sort of idealize them as solid spheres.
Sure.
And you can sit them into a, you know, a box or something, and how they're arranged would change how many spheres you can fit into a particular box. So sort of being able to calculate how much space in a crystal structure is empty and how much is full.
Right. Are there certain things that they would be given, though? Like calculate the atomic packing factor given, you know, the interatomic distance or something like that?
Yeah, so that's a good point, actually. Packing factors would require knowledge of some things, like maybe the unit cell parameter, which would be the length of the side of a cube, if you were dealing with a cubic structure. Or perhaps the atomic radius and a known crystal structure. Or I guess you could pick, you know, whichever of the unknowns that you want and supply just enough variables to be able to back out the other one through different means. So there's different ways to attack it depending on what your knowns are and what your unknowns are.
Okay, yeah, because you want to make it clear to students just what they'll have to do on tests, for example.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's a well-defined learning goal. Is there anything beyond that that you would want students to be able to do?
Oh, lots of things beyond that I'd like students to be able to do. If they can calculate packing factors for, you know, 3D structures, then they can break down 3D structures into individual atomic planes. and calculate planar densities or planar packing factors, which then can, you know, build into determining how a material is going to react when you put a load on it, and, you know, where are these atoms going to start slipping by each other and actually deforming. And so I think that's sort of, this is building up to sort of those higher level syntheses.
Mm-hmm. Sounds like you're talking about goals that would use predict as a verb. Can you come up with a goal that uses predict based on what you just said?
To maybe predict a preferred slip plane in a structure, given the structure and, well, actually really just given the structure should be enough. Yeah.